This next section is a quick look at science in general. The focus here is on how science works in the modern world. We'll look at the theory behind it, as well as some of the practical aspects of what it means to do science today. There are two basic assumptions that go into doing science. Neither of these has to be true, but the success of science as a way of explaining the world makes it seem likely that they are both in fact correct. The first assumption is that the universe operates by rules. In other words, there is something like a set of laws that govern how nature behaves. Notice that this assumption automatically excludes any supernatural phenomena. You can't use science to predict what a god can do unless the god is themselves governed by those same natural laws. That doesn't mean such gods don't exist, just that you can't determine it through science. The other assumption is that these rules can be figured out, at least at an approximate level. Once again, there's no reason why this has to be so. The rules could, in fact, be so complex and inscrutable that we could never work them out. However, our experience has been that many of the basic principles that seem to operate in the universe are understandable. So, how do we do science? There are several parts of the process we call science. The first one is being curious. If you don't ask questions, if you don't wonder how things work in the world around you, you're not going to want to start doing science. So curiosity is always the first step in the scientific process. The other two steps can come in either order, and usually people go back and forth between them many times. One of these steps is coming up with an explanation for what you see in the world. The fancy word for this is a hypothesis. There are several properties that make a hypothesis scientific. First, it has to make predictions. In other words, you have to be able to say that if your model is true, then you should observe certain things that didn't go into the model in the first place. If a model makes predictions, then it should be falsifiable. In other words, you should be able to say that if you observe something different, it will show that there's a problem with your hypothesis. If what you're proposing is so broad that it would explain any observation whatsoever, it really doesn't provide any explanation at all. The third part of a scientific hypothesis is that it has to rely on natural processes. That goes back to the first assumption in science: the universe operates by natural laws. Finally, the model has to be the simplest possible explanation that is consistent with all of the other rules. An example of a hypothesis, or really a whole set of hypotheses, is a model of an atom. We can't see the internal structure of an atom, so we have to make hypotheses about what it's like. The other key part of science is testing hypotheses. In other words, we make experiments or observations of the natural world to determine if our hypotheses work. For example, this picture shows Fermilab near Chicago, a place where experiments are done to test our models of what goes on inside the atom on the smallest scales possible. In astronomy, we rely mainly on observations for this. It's hard to bring a star or a planet into the lab and start doing experiments on it. However, we do have the whole universe doing experiments for us. All experiments and all observations have some measure of uncertainty. One of the key developments in 17th and 18th century science was the development of statistics. This allowed us to quantify uncertainty, meaning that we could tell when the uncertainty in our measurements was a real problem or something small enough that we didn't have to worry about. Right through to today, one of the key things any scientist wants to know about a measurement is, what is the uncertainty? Finally, it's important to appreciate that scientific models are always tentative. There's always a chance that some new observation or experiment will come along that will force you to alter the model. The better tested a model is, the less likely this is to happen, but it's always possible. For example, for over two centuries, Newton's laws of motion were the model of how things moved. They were so good that we still cover them today. However, in the early 20th century, it was shown that Newton's laws are only a really good approximation, and the special theory of relativity forms a more accurate description of how things move. Since scientific models are tentative, scientists are always testing old ideas to see if they still hold. Okay, here are two hypotheses. I'd like you to look them over and decide if they're testable. In other words, is there likely to be an observation or experiment a person could make that could falsify the model? You should explain why you do or don't think they're testable, and if they are testable, suggest a way that you might do this. Okay, here they are. First, children born when Jupiter is in the constellation Taurus are more likely to become musicians than other children. Second, aliens can manipulate time and memory so they can abduct people and perform experiments on them without the people realizing it. Notice, I'm not asking if these are right. I'm asking if they're testable. Not all scientific hypotheses are equal. Some cover such a wide range of observations and are so well tested that they become the framework for large branches of science. They can still be superseded, but it's difficult because they explain such a large number of observations. Here are a few examples of some of these big theories. Newton's laws of motion. Even though special relativity gives a more sophisticated view of motion, Newton's laws are still an important starting point for understanding how things move. Atomic theory, the model of the atom and what's inside it. Plate tectonics, which is probably the newest of the big theories and which explains much of what we see in the Earth's geology. Stellar evolution, the dominant model of how stars change over time. And finally, biological evolution, which underlies most of modern biology. Also, you shouldn't get hung up on terms like theory, hypothesis, model, and law. There is no set guideline defining when a theory becomes a law or a hypothesis turns into a model. Scientists are very sloppy about this, and often the names we use for things have more to do with their early history than what we think of them now. Any given branch of science often starts out with just gathering information. Scientists sometimes call this butterfly collecting. You're just collecting lots of facts and trying to put them together in as many different ways as you can to look for patterns. It's an important place to start, but science doesn't stop there. Once a science matures, it develops models that can be used to make predictions. As we've already seen, making predictions is the key to testing a scientific hypothesis. But making predictions involves a high level of critical thinking. You've got to be able to take a general concept and use it to extrapolate from what you already know into things you don't know but can test. So that's why we do so many what-if questions in this class. Science isn't just about knowing the facts. It's about making predictions based on models. That's why Henri Poincaré, the late 19th, early 20th century mathematical physicist, said, "Science is built up with facts as a house is with stones. But a collection of facts is no more of science than a heap of stones is a house." We've looked at the theory of science, that is, the working model of what science is about. However, this doesn't really tell you what a scientist actually spends their days doing. So that's what I'd like to focus on now. Well, what I'm describing applies specifically to the U.S. Something like this operates most places nowadays. A modern scientific research project generally starts with a research proposal. The proposal exists for two reasons. One, most scientists are not so independently wealthy that they can pay for all of their own research, so they have to convince someone else to pay for it instead. And two, sometimes the only way you can get access to the kind of equipment you need is to ask for permission to use it. So who provides money and equipment for science? That depends on the field. If there's an obvious commercial application to a science, in other words, if it's going to lead to something you can sell, then there are many private companies that put a lot of money into their research efforts. In fields like medicine and electronics, many companies pay for basic research because they know this can lead to marketable products. However, in fields like astronomy, with very little sellable application, most of the money comes from government agencies and private, non-profit foundations, like the Carnegie Institute. In astronomy, the most important agencies are NASA and the National Science Foundation. For example, the National Science Foundation puts up the money to build and maintain national observatories, like this radio observatory in New Mexico. you can get a sense of how much money is spent by specific agencies and on specific projects by following the link to the How Big is Science chart from Scientific American. Writing a research proposal means giving a very detailed rundown of exactly what you plan to do, why you plan to do it, why you have the expertise to do it, and why anybody should care enough to pay for it. When you send your proposals in for review, it will usually be gone over by a group of other scientists who have to rank your proposal against many others and make recommendations about who gets how much funding. Of course, this also means that if you write proposals, there's a good chance that sooner or later you'll be asked to serve on one of these review panels. Once your proposal is accepted, then you need to do the actual research. Here we often see a division of labor reflecting the two sides of the scientific process. There are some people who are specialists in the observational or experimental side of science. Others are more focused on developing the models or theories in science. This leads to a sort of friendly rivalry between the two groups. The observers are always trying to come up with an observation that will test somebody's favorite theory, and the theorists are always trying to come up with models that explain somebody's bizarre observations. This is a healthy thing for science. It makes it less likely that people will get complacent about either side of the process. Lastly, once you've done your work, you need to let others know about it. While the public often sees press releases and web announcements about science, the most important way to get the information out into the scientific world is through refereed journals. These journals are special because of the process they go through to review the papers they publish. If you have a cool new observation of a distant binary star, then you'll start out by writing out your work in enough detail that someone who wants to could reproduce the whole thing. No secret formulas here. Then, when you submit your paper, it goes to the journal editor, who immediately calls on one or two other experts in the field and asks them to referee your paper. A referee's job is to find every problem that exists in your paper. This could be something small, like you haven't explained your work clearly. Or it could be big things, like you're doing something wrong, or the conclusions don't match your results. The referee then sends their report to the editor, who sends it back to the author. Usually, after one or two back and forths between the referee and the author, the paper is ready for publication and it goes into the journal. Of course, once you've submitted a paper or two for publication, the journal editors will start calling you up to referee other people's papers as well. Getting published in a research journal doesn't guarantee that the results of the work are correct. People can still get it wrong. However, it does mean that the work has been through a sort of basic sanity check. Also, once a paper is published, it's part of the record on that subject. If someone else is doing work in that field, they will have to reference your paper if it's relevant, even if it's just explaining why they think you're wrong. The last topic I'd like to look at in this chapter is pseudoscience. A pseudoscience is something that uses the language of science without going through all the parts of the process. Pseudoscience is very common, and it comes in many different forms. However, there are a few things that you can look for that can be hints that what you're seeing is pseudoscience. The first of these is that the work hasn't been published in a refereed journal. News articles often start out by listing which major journal a scientific result was published in. If you don't see that, it should be a red flag that it may not have been checked over by someone who understands the field. Another aspect of pseudoscience is the trend toward having public debates over scientific questions. Scientific questions are never settled in public debating forums. It's done through research publications and meetings. If someone wants to try to argue a controversial scientific question through a debate in a public forum, it's worth wondering why they aren't doing the same thing with an audience of people who are experts in the field instead. Next, you should be careful when someone's results seem very inconsistent with what other people have done. Of course, this is harder to do if you don't know the field. Sometimes you'll hear a pseudoscientific idea that claims to explain everything in physics, or medicine, or whatever. When you hear this, you should ask yourself, what observation would disprove it? If there isn't one, it's not science. Next up, Always watch for cases where someone is using science to sell you something. It is very often true that what you're being given is a sales pitch, not an accurate report on the science. One large branch of pseudoscience is built around the assumption that ancient cultures were privy to hidden information about the world that modern people don't know. It is certainly true that ancient peoples weren't stupid and often had detailed knowledge of things like their immediate environment that we may lack today. However, when someone starts claiming that these cultures had information requiring technologies far beyond what they, or even we, have available, it's a pretty good sign that the person making the claims has moved into the realm of pseudoscience. Finally, one of the most common hallmarks of pseudoscience is the invocation of conspiracy theories. When someone tries to paint a picture of a vast conspiracy of scientists trying to prevent their work from coming out, this is usually one of the surest signs that what they're presenting is pseudoscience.